Surely, Lord Jesus Christ, there is no name like your name, O Father. Once we hear that name of the Lord Jesus, we know every knee shall bow, Father. Father God, you say whatever we do, let us do it in your name. We are gathering in your presence tonight, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. Come down and help us, O Father, so we know your presence mightily among us. We commit the remaining of the service in your hand as your children are praying. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. While we are standing, just let's read God's word, and we go right away to... I'm trying to figure out what was it. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Let's read book of Leviticus 25. Just want to go that way. Maybe we much easier. Starting with verse 25. Excuse me. Leviticus 25:25. It's Friday sometime and we have communion. Are we trying to make sure that everything would be good time? Are we there? 25:25, Leviticus. We shall read. Now people are still looking for. 25:25. I'm waiting for you. Old Testament. Leviticus. Just after Exodus, I think. Yes, after Exodus. You start to learn to see where the things are in the Bible. It's a good practice. Find it 25:25. Okay. Shall read. If thy brother be waxen poor and hath sold away some of his possession, and if any of his kin come to redeem it, then shall he redeem that which his brother sold. And if the man have none to redeem it, and himself be able to redeem it, then let him count the years of the sales thereof, and restore the surplus unto the man to whom he sold it, that he may return into his possession. But if he be not able to restore it to him, then that which is sold shall remain in the land, in the hand of him that had bought it, until the year of Jubilee. And in the Jubilee it shall go out, and he shall return dwelling house in a walled city, then he may redeem it within a whole year after it is sold. Within a full year may he redeem it. And if it be not redeemed within the space of a full year, then the house that is in the walled city shall be established forever to him that bought it. Throughout his generation shall not go out in the Jubilee. May the Lord add a blessing on the reading of his word. You may be seated. I was just trying to find the scripture to read and to figure out how I can kind of say a little bit on closing what we were talking. I'm still staying on the same subject of really, it's not about the Jubilee, but it's about returning to our possession. Now, if you read very well the scripture, we just read there because there are so many things. If you have a time again, just go read all those chapters of Leviticus 25 and also probably Exodus 21, I think. Yes, 21. If you read those, you will find out something very interesting, like I was trying to point the other day. When God was able to deliver the children of Israel from the bondage in Egypt, and they were on a witness, and after a while, God called Moses on the Mount Sinai, and he told him, I gave him a law. Now, something very interesting is that God don't take someone out of the bondage to put him in a different bondage. When God frees someone, is to free him, like the Jesus said, once you know the truth shall you set free, and you'll be free indeed. Amen. Now, sometimes we don't understand the freedom of God. I'm just trying to figure out one way. Freedom of God, it's freedom. Okay, let me put it this way. You are free to serve God. That's how the, okay. See, I want to put it this way. Sometimes people think, yes, I'm free. But the freedom that we got has only one purpose. We are free from the servant, which is the Egypt, which is the devil, is to serve God. Most of the time we forgot that second part. We know that Jesus set us free. Jesus paid our debt. Jesus did, oh, he got that freedom. But we forgot the part that follow. The freedom that God gave us is to serve him. So it's kind of a freedom. I don't know. I don't want to expect that beyond that, because I might put a spin that is not correct. Because God, when we go serve God, it's not a second bondage. You see, that's kind of what we want to understand. When you serve your first master, I'm just trying to make these things a little bit simple. When you serve the master, you are not only a servant, you are also on bondage. Now, if you read the book of Galatians, you're going to find that, of course, sometimes the Bible, Paul used that term like, you know, we are in a bond. I mean, it's like when you serve Jesus Christ, you owe respect, you owe service to your master, and your master owe you direction. He have to tell you what you need to do. So God cannot call you for a service without telling you. So I was just trying to kind of lay that things down so I can figure out a way to go around. One of the points I read, why I read this, well, I want just to talk maybe for 35 minutes. It's about the things I was not about to mention last time very clear. Now, for those, I felt very uncomfortable when I use big word like, I was using those Greek words. I trying to avoid that. But if someone wants to know how those words work and where they are on it, Bible, just ask the pastor or ask me, we can tell you where they are. Now, you will find when we read here, one thing is coming back, like we talk about in verse 27, he said this, and it shall return to his possession. You're going to read, and it shall return to his possession. It's something that is coming, because something that happened is when God delivered them, he sent them to promised land. He opened the promised land. He gave them possession. Mm-hmm. Now, I will come back to that word possession. Because when we hear possession in God's word, most of the time we think, about material possession. Which is true. Which is God gave them land. God gave them a lot of things. But it's a very important to understand first thing that we belong to God. I like the way my brother put it, the pastor put it all the time. Someone owns you. I love it. Each time I heard that, you know, and I just remind you a simple thing that with someone owns you. You are not your own. Someone owns you. Yeah. We have to remember that. God owns us. And I just remind you those things because now, the land that God gave them belongs to God. Now, it's a very important point in the Bible because I'm trying to use the type and just to kind of making a small point. The land belongs to God. You see? Now, we know that the promised land is a type of the Holy Ghost. The promised land belongs to God. And God took what belonged to him. Then he asked Joshua to divide it and to give it according to what God already planned. Now, if you read Exodus, Yes, just where we read 25, 23. The Bible said this. We're starting on 25, but I'm going to read 23 and 24. The land shall not be sold forever, for the land is mine. For you are strangers and sojourners with me. And in all the land of your possession, you shall grant a redemption for the land. Now, something is very important here. The land should never be sold forever. Although they gave them the land, each one has a portion of the land. Now, you have to keep in mind that God, just to make it short, God gave us the Holy Ghost, a portion of the Holy Ghost, but it belonged to God. You see? Now, do whatever you want with to do with the Holy Ghost, but you will never be able to sell that someone. You know, see, a lot, that's why you see all those people, they take that portion of God. That's why it's very bad when God gives you a gift to use it for some peculiar benefit. Whatever, for any reason, you might sell it for the money, you might sell it for any reason, you might just say because you want to have control over people. You are taking any benefit from what God gave to you. And so we got to be very careful with God's gift. Of course, God, we said that God gave to you, God cannot cannot take it back. Well, one thing I was thinking about when I was thinking about this, about selling, something that came, it was about the price tag. I want to talk a little bit about the price tag. Keep this in mind. Everything you got from God is free. Oh my God. Okay, now you see? Everything you get from God is free. I want that to soak in you, because sometimes people think that you are giving God something for what He's giving back to you. Now, at each time, the price that you feel pain on, that you think that you are paying God, or you are doing something really that you think you are doing, really is just trying to get away from the one who's holding you. Now, tell me, what are you giving in exchange with what God is giving to you? If you think about that, nothing. Think about, what are you giving in exchange to get something from God? Think, just if you, because I thought about that. Nothing. If you look at everything you are giving up, let's say giving up between buckets, really, it's just something that has nothing to do with that. You are not giving God anything in exchange of that. What? Your time? What are you going to give God in exchange of what He gave to you? So, the price tag that we're trying to put on a service that we do to God, it's not really the price tag that we think it is. It is not. The devil is the one who puts a price tag. Now, anything you get from him has a price. There is nothing you can get from the devil that you get for free. Okay. Can you buy love? You get that from God. How much can you pay for love? That's what God gave you. How much can you pay for love? The true love. Zero. You cannot. It's priceless. What else you get from God? Give me one thing. Patience. How much you pay for. Anything that you get from God, there is no price for it. You see, we have to understand sometimes, because sometimes I feel so bad. People think, I left this, I did this, I did this. You make it sound like you gave something to God. So what you are getting in return from God? Let me just, something came on my about the price tag. What did you give to God to get what God gave to you? What are you giving to God now to what God is giving to you? Money? Time? Health? What? Everything we have, God gave to us. Everything we have, God gave to us. You see, and those are the things that I just want to move on. But we might come later because I get very frustrated. Because I start to think about, you know, like I come on a Friday, I'm so tired. Then I look at, wow, tired by what? What made me tired today? Serving God? Think about that. I'm tired. Okay, fine. Why am I tired? Serving God? You see, when you start to look at your life that way, then you start to understand that it's a different way when we deal with God. You cannot tell God that, oh God, I was doing this. I cannot tell God I was working. I cannot. Did I send you this earth to work? You see, just so you understand that we do things that sometime. Now, before I forgot, I wish I had that board. I was asking my brother there, maybe we find a nice board, because the room is nice, we don't like that post standing there. We got to find a better way to have a thing like that. Let me explain you something about a jubilee. Now, just between the bracket, I'm really counting my like my time. First of all, a true Israelite, he could never be servant of anybody else. Now, if he becomes servant for someone, or you buy a servant from an Israelite, he can only serve you 6 years. After the 7 years, you got to let him go. That's the way it was, just God's way of doing things. He cannot, I mean, because you have to remember that sometimes we do things, we serve, and not the master. It's a limited time. Now, that was not the main part. Because the main part is, explain to Jubilee, those seven years, if you count 7 years, seven times, it becomes 50 years, the 49, the 58th year of the Jubilee. Now, all the price, first of all, if I will come, this is an Israelite, and then I say, this guy, I want to be your master, I want to get you to serve me. That person will never be a bond servant. A bond servant means it's the slave. You're in a bond, you do whatever you want to do with him because it's your slave. Every Israelite have to be what they call in the Bible, hire servant. Hireling servant, meaning you take him someone like someone who said you got to pay him back. You got to pay him some salary. You hire him. Now, it's a very hard to get that. You cannot just take him to serve him like a slave, which they call a bond servant. You have to take him like what they say in French, a mercenaire. It's someone, he came like, he put himself in your service, you got to pay him in return for what he's doing for you. Now, for a bond servant, you might or you might not pay him as a slave. And you cannot do that for an Israelite. Now, if he serve you after 7 years, he's free. After 6 years, the seventh is free to go. You cannot keep him more than 7 years. Now, if someone, or let's just say you want to buy, and then it comes out about the Jubilee. If that's why we read today, if someone have to be sold and he cannot be redeemed or free, you have to count, the price were always been counting how many years left after before you reach Jubilee. That's the what we call the surplus. Because if I buy you, I know that you have only 1 year left. At the Jubilee, I'm free to go. So I cannot pay too much money because in 1 year, you are going to be free. You see, everything, that's why I just make this small point. I'm going to, just to make you understand why that thing was very important. Regardless what it is, God gave to each child of Israel a possession. Each one of them has something. Now, you cannot say that you are a born-again child of God. You have nothing from God. Oh, I kind of throw that off. You see how I spin it? It's just like, I didn't get anything from God. Really? Then you are not son of God. You are not son of God. You see, because those things don't match. As soon as you say you are a son of God, remember, God gave you a position. Now, are you going to change to say you didn't get anything from God? It's up to you, it's up to me to find what God gave us. You see? Because that's the most important thing is what God gave to you. The rest, you know, we ask God so many things. Don't misunderstand me. Don't misunderstand me. We ask God many things. And God gave us those things. Because he said he's going to grant to us the desire of our heart. You see? Now, there are things that God decided by himself to give to us. I said, I'm going to get you. I said, those kids, very tricky. I'm going to send to a land already prepared, where milk and, you know, promised land. It was not something that the Israelites asked to God. You see, they were trying to make it something very important. Because I'm not saying that you cannot. Promised land, it is something that God planned himself to give to them. According to what already predestinated, so you are going to live there, you are going to live there. So we have to know that in our life, as a son of God, we have things that God's planning to give to us. Yeah. Each time you are a son of God, you have a portion of God. You have a part of God. God cannot, it doesn't matter. Brother Branham said these things on the things that are to be. He said, who is that parent? Before even his child is born, he will prepare everything. The child don't make it say, I want this, I want this. Of course, the child, when he's born, is going to ask his dad a bunch of stuff. But there are things that the child will have regardless what he asks, because that the dad and mom, they prepare that. I say, Brother Branham say, if you, you can do that kind of preparation, how much God can prepare something for you before even you come, you are born again. So keep this in mind. As soon as you are born again, there is something that you have, you see from God. So if you say you have never received something from God, then that's fine. It's possible. Meaning you are not his child. Which is kind of flip the things in the wrong way. Because all of us say we are children of God. So by saying that, meaning we got something from God, because God is good. He's always a thing. So now, I'm so happy. I'm kind of, I don't know even why. You see, it's a very important, it's those nuances are very important because a second point is this. Once you know what God gave to you, which portion that God gave to you, you are going to hold that dearly. Amen. You will know why God set you in this earth to serve him. Remember, I was talking about the other day about Solomon building the temple. It's something that we are not really we don't think a little bit about that. We already heard that. Each one of us heard that. Why did God send me here? We already heard that question before. I'm just repeating something we already heard. Because now I'm flipping the coin. Yeah, God is good. We go to God. I need the healing. I need this. I need this. God is blessing us. I need this. That's fine. That's the part that we want from God. Now, just God just throw you there for nothing. If you check problems, you know what? He said, if you are a servant, a true servant, when he have to go to his master, ask master, you know what? I know. Why did you bring me here? I have to do something. What do I have to do? That's why the master is duty bound to tell you to give you direction. That's the duty of the master. He has to tell you what you need to do and to give you the direction of how to do it. Your servant, my duty as a servant, is to obey the master, to provide the service that the master requires for me. That's our relationship between God and us. Now, that's why I say, take my yoke. You know the yoke, right? That the things they put on the ox nugs to labor. He said, my yoke is easy. My yoke is easy. I mean, you have to walk along with that. I mean, you have to take a yoke because you have something to do. That's why Jesus said, take my yoke. I mean, it's just not for the sake of saying, take my yoke. No, you have something to do. The good thing is that yoke, it's easy. You see, that's the good things. You know what? That's the God that we serve. He gave us something that we can do. That's what I heard last Wednesday. God, we talk about that on a prayer meeting again. God will never ask you something that you cannot do. Never. God is not like that. Everything that God asks us to do, we know that we are able to do. Every service God asks us to do, God knows that we're already equipped to do it. So this is kind of something I want. It's just kind of close this because I'm telling you why we have to return. Probably tomorrow, God willing, I'm going to kind of say how, because I talk a why. I'm going to just talk a little bit a why in a different way, and we'll be done my brief because I just want to close that. It's a long subject, but I want you to understand that the biggest problem here is that possession belongs to you. You see, and Brother Branham said this, God has given the church a portion, which is Christ himself. Amen. You see the good side? So when we talk about the possession, I say God gave us stuff. The only thing that God gave to the church is Christ himself. Amen. Do we get more than that? Yes. He said, seek first the kingdom of God, and all the surplus we shall give unto you. The surplus, that's fine. God is ready to give you the surplus. Most of the time, we forgot the thing. We want the surplus. You see, that's the biggest problem we have in the church. The church wants to get the surplus. God, give me this. God, give me this. But he said, that's fine. I will give you all this. But I want to give you first Christ. You see why the point? That's the portion that God gave to his church today. It's Christ himself. Because once you get Christ, you get everything. You get God himself. And then everything shall be added on top of that. So don't try to verse. Abraham said something. God to do that, to express, how did God give us Christ? That's why Jesus said this. It's a good thing I have to go. If I don't go, you won't be able to receive it. Right. The disciples said, no, master, you cannot go. We are so pleased to be visited. You know what? If I don't go, you'll be in trouble. Right. Because it's a good thing I got to go, because once I go, then you can get it. Amen. I won't leave you, child. I won't give you comfortless. Amen. I will send you the comforter, which is Christ himself, going to dwell in you. Amen. Then you will be my servant. Then you will be my disciples. Then the offering will be added on top of that. So you become really God's servant. Come back until you, when you get that possession, when you get Christ on you, that's the possession that we got from God. Now, the possession was some, that we say, if I think it's in the book of Ephesians when it says, we have been predestinated to be sons of God. Meaning to receive God, to receive Christ. Now, one thing important is this. Now, I was talking last Sunday, I think, about the old stones. It's like we are different. Meaning when we are different, we receive different portion of Christ. We receive different portion of the Holy Ghost. And that acted differently. So, I already talked about that last Sunday. Now, Reverend, I'm saying something important. This possession giving part, it's a God part of doing it. So that's God's grace. I want you to finish that part. So if you want that God's grace to give you that portion, why I stay longer? Because we keep on forgetting when we go to God how important it is to receive the Holy Ghost. When we talk about receiving the Holy Ghost, sometimes people think like, it's just something, oh yeah, I got it, and then it. You have to keep, you have to hold on that position. It's God give you something, you have to learn to hold on that. Because, keep in mind, oh, I think about that scripture brother read about in the book of Job. When God was having his meeting, the devil went there, and God kind of provoked the devil. Really, it was God who started the thing. God is the one who provoked the devil. The devil was just like scratching his head, passing around, watching these people talking. You know, he wanted to be a part of the talk, but it seems like God just looked at him and said, hey, where are you coming from? Oh, yeah, I come from earth, going to and fro, just wandering. That's what he is, just wandering all around. Then he asked me, you know, by the way, you weren't bad there. Have you seen my friend, my servant, Job? Well, I was blessed last week when I came back from my when I said, have you seen my servant, Job? There is no one like him. Now, I love it because now God is making, is testifying. That's what I love. God is testifying about Job. God is testifying. It's not me. It's not the pastor. It's not the brother. It's God himself. I said, that man there is none like him. He's telling the devil. I love it. God is telling the devil, have you seen my friend, the Job? There is no one like him. You know, kind of, you know what they say in English, God kind of boasting about Job. Kind of say, you know, that's my man. Now, what I didn't know until last week when I heard my brother preaching on a prayer meeting, it was the answer of the devil. That's what really rejoiced me. It was not a God testimony. It was the devil answer. It changed my life. That's why I told you, son, I said, I'm going to tell you about something about that God. The devil talk changed my life. On that point, it was something that, wow, I didn't know it. When the pastor laid that, I said, oh my God, this is it? Now, if we knew, I'm gonna read that. Brother, remember, is it Job 3 or Job 1? Oh, how am I gonna find it? You don't, I mean, oh, you are the one who talk about that, you forgot. The Job 3, let's go in the book of, it's a couple of the beginning of the, it's something good. I don't know why I'm there. It's a Job 1st chapter. Yes, Job the 1st chapter. If you can go back there, I want you to see something that really, I don't know, it just changed. It was so good to me. It was so good to me. Then, because when God called you, when God gave you, he is a good God. Amen? Yeah. He's a good God. I'm quoting. Just starting in, yes, so verse 7 on the first chapter of Job. Just in the beginning of the book of Job. Verse 7. And the Lord say unto Satan, whence comest thou? What do you? Okay, I love it. Do you think that God didn't know where Satan come from? God knows everything. God sees everything. Man, if you read the Bible, you're going to find that God asked those questions as if he didn't know what was going on. And I always wonder about that. God asks those kind of questions. Those are not the questions. He knows the answer. You see? That's the kind of the question that God is. Where are you from? Where do you come from? God knew where. God sees everything because God is omnipresent. But if someone in this wisdom can read the Bible and say, oh yeah, God was wondering. He didn't know where the Satan was. He knows where Satan is. And they say, where are you coming from? And he said this, and 7. And he said, then Satan swear the Lord. And he said, from going to and fro on the earth and from walking up and down. That's what he goes. Everywhere. Everywhere. Even here. Everywhere. Up and down. To and fro. Everywhere. Now, and the Lord said, verse 8. And the Lord said to Satan, hast thou considered? I like that word, consider. It's not just see. Consider, meaning you look at, you observe, you watch every, that's what they call consider. Consider is not just, okay, have you seen my friend? No. Have you looked at the way he lives? Have you considered my servant Job? You see, but now that was talking about the servant. You see, God here is job is God's servant. Now, in the end, my job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man. That's why God said we must be perfect. Yeah, but that guy was perfect, according to what God said. Now, say this. One that, I love it, because now, look at this. Job was doing something that was a point of thought. Did he say that guy never missed the service on Sunday? That guy pay always the tithe? That's not what God is saying. God is saying that man, a couple of things he does. He fear God and eschew evil. He does a couple of things. He fear God. That's first thing. And he just don't want to do any evil. If we learn to do those couple of things, think how God will be happy for us. Just two things. Is it hard? Just to fear God. You know why? We don't fear God enough. We don't. I'm going to come back then. I know after 30 minutes, we're going to get a communion anyway. We don't fear God. Job feared God. And that's the word he should, like, kind of, he didn't want, he shunned the evil by all means. Now, the devil looking like that. The devil is what the, now listen what the devil said. That's what I loved. I love that. Then Satan answered the Lord and say, okay, that's fine. I say, and then God, you answer me. God, you answer me. You think about, that's how the devil is. I say, God, you answer me. And he's saying, do Job fear God for nothing? You see, that's the devil. If a question, what do you mean? He fear you just for nothing. That's the talk. Oh, yeah, he said, Job is a man. He fear me and they don't want evil. Say, by the way, does he do that for nothing? But now you tell me, as they do that, I mean, he didn't even want God to answer. He keep on talking. He said, do you think that Job, that's the way we always treat God? That when we see something like that, God is blessing that brother. You think that God is blessing nothing? We always link God blessing with doing something. That's the devil language. That's fine. God can bless you for doing nothing. You see, now, just love God. Just love God. God is going to bless you. God knows what you need. God knows what I need. Now, if you ask God things, he's going to give you. That's why Brother Branham said that sometimes God gives us what they call the permissive will. The things that we just bother him so much. I say, you know what? Just go get it. I'm going to give you in trouble. God is going to give you things that can get you in trouble. God will give you. He knows in the long run you're going to get you in trouble and then you come back crying. Oh, God. Oh, I don't want to get on the detail, because if I get on the detail, it will be terrible. How many things we ask God? Okay, I don't know. Even a work, even a job. He will give you a very good job. But we take all your being, you will be able to serve God. God is the one who gave you the job. The same job. You know what? Okay, that's why I said I don't want to get into the detail. Because if I gave you an example, you can ask God anything. You know, the point is this. Once you ask God something, if you don't give him room to make his decision, the last decision, I'm going to give you because he loves you, because he loves me. He's going to give you. But you say, God, you know what? I want to get this. Maybe it's not right, but you know what? Let your will be done. At the end of the day, give him some room. And when you don't get it, say, thank you, God. We never thank you, God, because we didn't get what we asked. I can give you a quote about that. Because any answer from God is a good answer. Okay, I will give you a simple example. You were about to go in there, the brother didn't show up. You want to go so bad. Oh, I will give you a real example. My son-in-law, every Sunday, every 12 o'clock, he go to lunch with his boss. And one day, the boss come in and say, Gee, let's go for lunch. He said, oh, no, I don't want to go. I'm just going to stay in the office. Now, you can flip it. You know what? He didn't want. It was bad. The boss was upset. Whatever it is. Because we didn't go eat together. Now, the boss drive. Less than 10 minutes, got an accident. Like we call the T. It was hit by a car just on the side. Exactly where the passenger sit. The car had been total. If Guy was in the car, he was gone. The car is exactly where he was supposed to stay, to sit, if I be on lunch. Now, we might say that, well, those are the things that God does. You might not like the things that the way it comes, but hindsight, in long run, oh, yeah, now I understand. Because you gave room, you give God room to do things. Now, my point is, I don't want to lose my idea. Now I go to the job because I want to lose it. Now, does this job do that for nothing? Listen, the devil said this. He said this. Does job fear you, God, for nothing? Has not thou made a hedge about him? It's not you, God, that you went there and you put all those barricades around him. Now, do you know that there are barricades around you? You don't know that, but the devil knows it. Because he tried to come close to you, then he found the wall. He tried to go this way, he found the wall. He tried all the way to go through Job. There was barricade all around Job. Then he said, why not he cannot fear? Because you put barricade around him. That's what the devil said. Why? Because around us, there are hedges that God had already put. The devil sees it. You might not see it, but the devil cannot reach you unless God allow him. Because I heard that so many times, I could not get hold of it until 2 weeks ago. I heard that so many times as a preacher going to church, people said the devil can never get on hold on you until God allow him or you open the door. I heard that so many times, but I wanted something strong to find in the scripture that I know that the devil will never be able to get around me until God allows it. If you know it, something happened to you, you will be happy. You know that God allow it. If you know that, the way I believe now, nothing can happen to me until God don't allow it. Nothing. Nothing cannot happen to me until God allow it. And I'm so convinced about that. Since that day, it changed my life. Yeah. That's why I said, I told you, you know what? Something happened to me that will change me forever. Nothing can touch me unless God allow it. That's how I believe. Nothing can touch me unless God allow it. Because around me, God has built way, ages. I believe that so strongly. That's what God is for you and I. Once you know that you'll be happy. You will never scream or cry. You know that this is a test. This is something that God. You know what they said? Now, it was not good. The devil is telling God that, he's telling you and I that, you know what? God already protects you. And he said, not all. He said this. You has not thou made a hedge about him, about house? The devil cannot get in your house until God allow it. Now, if things are coming in your house, only two things. There is a door that is open by you, or it's a test that God allow it. Now you got to check. The first one, it's up to you to find out. The second one is to rejoice that God is testing you. So, regardless how the things come, it's always, thank God. You see, I'm trying to make you understand the simple things so you understand. Don't blame God. God is good. God has a good plan for us. God cannot, you know, when you walk, you know that there is angel around me. The devil cannot touch me. You buffer. He can come. You know what? He's roaring like a lion, looking for wood to devour, but he cannot. Have you never seen? Have you never seen a chicken trying to catch a cockroach within a clear bottle? It's going to hit on a bottle like this. Tick, tick, tick. It cannot. The cockroach is so happy inside of the bottle because it's protected. I'm not saying you are cockroaches. I'm saying just that's the way it is. I'm sorry. I don't know. Sometimes I say things I don't even know what I say. I don't know where it comes from. Forgive me if I said that in the wrong way. Anyway, he didn't say that. He said this. Has thou not, okay, around about his house, about all that he had on every side? That has blessed is the work of his hand. The substance is increasing. You see? And then he said, you know, but put forth the hand and just let him. Just let me just do something, we say. You know, I like the verse. That's why I just want you to read. So I'll go home, take that verse 10, and just circle it. Each time you get in trouble, read it again. Read it again. Each time you get in trouble, just read that again. Job 1:10. God has put a hedge around me. So anyway, that's the way. When God gives you a possession, you cannot sell it. So that I want to go see. That's God's grace. That's God's grace. Oh no, I want just to rush on something. Okay, that's fine. Brother Branham said this. Men fail, men will fail, and had always fail. Always fail. But God always going to give grace to man. 10 minutes, 20 minutes, let me say something, then I might flip it the other way on, maybe tomorrow, God willing, on a Sunday. Now, there is something that goes in the Jubilee. It's like the servant can make a decision that I just want to stay with my servant. That's where we know that they put a hole on his ear and they put a mark there. Everybody will see the mark that this guy is already a servant for life because he chose to do it. That's not where I want to really to stay longer on that, but we can back that. Ramanam said something I wanted to just to mention a couple of things. He said this. God gave the Holy Ghost to the church. The church at this end time, the blessing. Now, it's easy when we come here, we say, yeah, God is blessing us. What God, the Holy Ghost is. I believe that. But if you look at really honestly, the church is so weak spiritually that we got to be a bit ashamed to say that we are Christian. Now, I'm saying this with a lot of respect without being judgmental. I'm just trying to say, not even before we reach the level where we are. It has been a long time before, even before you are converted. If you look at the church today, we are so below what God asks us to do. We are so low. We are so low that I could read you the quote probably we read it today. Because I'm checking my time. We cannot, Prabhupada say, we want so easy way. We cannot sustain any pressure. The church has grown up in number. You can go in, like in Africa, every corner, you see a church of the Message Believe Church. Every corner, in Congo, whatever. But spiritually speaking, it's even worse than the people, the church denomination where they left. It's worse. I don't want to badmouth this church. We are not way beyond those people neither. You know what I call formalism? The thing we do? That's what we do. I'm going to take 5 minutes. The communion is there. I asked this question last Sunday. Honestly, where is the last time you pray? Honestly, really pray. Very few people pray. I'm not talking about this. I asked that question. So I can read. Then the reader say, the way, now, if you say we do, but that's fine. Let's see something happening. We'll see the result of the Holy Ghost among us. That's the bottom line. Do you think that I'm different than you? No, we're on the same boat. We are on the same boat because the men, all the group can be blessed. So I cannot include myself. Now, Reverend Nam says something really, it kind of shocked me. He said, sometimes persecution, when difficulties happen, That's what puts people close to God. When I read that, you probably on Sunday to tell you those kind of things. We like easy things. We like the easy way. You know, while I was thinking about that, then I thought about this thought that I'm going to end by that because I just want to forget it because I seem like I got a lot of mistakes like that. Most of us here, like I look at you people, most of us can say we live a sanctified life. Most of us can say that. I don't sin, I don't commit, I don't do the evil thing. Most of us can say that. You see what I say? I pound my word. Most of us, I didn't say all of us, can say that, which is fine in a church. We call that living a sanctified life. Most of us can say they do that. They don't steal, they don't commit adultery, they don't do those things that they are really evil. But very few of us live a consecrated life. Very few of us live a consecrated life. Amen. I repeat that so many times so you understand. 90% of us can say we live a sanctified life. But maybe 2 or 5% just live a consecrated life. And because I thought about this. Less than 5% live a consecrated life. Then I called my wife. She was talking, he told me no bosses. I said, you know what, B? This something's going on in my heart. Then he asked me, what is a consecrated life? She asked me that question. Now, you see, that's the thought I want us to think, because to see the kind of things we want to see from God. And I checked in the Bible. I checked on what I know. Every place where we saw that mighty hand of the Holy Ghost, you have to be on a consecrated life. You have to live a consecrated. I don't know. I'm going to explain a little bit about the consecrated life. Because I'm trying to figure out how I'm going to find the message to explain that easily. Less than now, if we want the thing that we have seen in the act happening in our church, we have to live a consecrated life. We have to live a consecrated life. I'm not blaming. I'm not saying that you are sinner. I'm sinner. No, I'm not saying that. Don't misunderstand me. We are sent. Because we are living a sanctified life. We don't do things that, you know, we do all things, we come to church. This is not what we call consecrated life. Coming to church, it's consecrated beyond coming to church. Amen. Consecrated life, it's beyond just sitting 2 hours reading your Bible, praying for the food. It's beyond that. Now tell me one person that has been mightily used with God that did not live a consecrated life. One person. I'm talking about those people like the Shunammite, those people, they didn't know God. It was just by their faith they could move God. That's fine. This is beyond faith. This, what I'm talking about, it's beyond faith. You have the faith. Fine. But to get what we are looking for, we need to change a little bit. We need to live a life that is more dedicated than the way we dedicate that God. And that nobody can do for you. Nobody. That's what I'm talking about. You know, I say I forget about it because I'm looking at them. I just want, if I can forget everything, let me make this point first. Then I'm going to, you know what? You know, start to know the way I function. I mean, I'm not trying to get myself out of this picture. No. I'm in the same boat like you are. But let's do something different. We won't get anything from God living the way we're living as a Christian. Now, you want scriptures. I can give you. I will give you. But I want you to understand the point, what I'm trying to make. There is something. I just want, but we're talking about the pastor the other day. They said, think about this. God, Jesus Christ. One, he knows that tomorrow, because he knows everything, I have a big fight. I'm going to cross the river. I'm going to go the other side of the lake. There is someone, the thousand of demons have possessed one person there. Legion of them are in one person. God, before that, said the disciple, go. I have to dedicate myself before I go to that fight. The prophet said, God went to the mountain praying. God got to pray before going for the legion. That's what they call consecrated life. You see, has nothing. Jesus have never seen. You talk about a saint, he was sent himself. But he knows that the one is going to fight now. That's the difference. Why we could not cast out the demon? I said, that kind of demon is only through fasting and prayer. You cannot cast the demon out. The epileptic one. He said, that kind, it's only through fasting and praying. Dedication. Consecration life. You cannot get that kind. Oh, we cannot pray for the demon. That's not the kind of the demon you take like that. We need more than that for that kind of demon. I said, you want scripture? I can give you scriptures. I'm giving you scripture about what the consecrated life is. It's not something. Why we keep on fooling God? We, me included. That's not the way. I mean, I've seen that. I sit there. That's my place. This is what it's about. We have to change. This is in your room. When you see yourself, you sleep, you look at the ceiling and say, what have I done for God today? Look at Brother Branham and say, you know, honey, I'm going out to that place. I'm going to pray. I won't be back until. You see, I love that. I won't be back until. You see? Now, it was not, he meant business. Meaning he has a goal until. You see, when you go to see God, you have to have until. What are you trying to get from God? I'm not saying that you have to pay. That, you know, you see what I put it? I say, it's not a price you are paying. You are not paying a price. The price you are paying, you are getting away of the demon. That's the price you are paying. To forsake the world, that's the price you are paying. If that you call that a price. The, what the devil gave us. It's hard to get rid of the devil. It's hard. Once he gets you, you give him a finger, he takes all your being. It's very expensive to get. You know, that's a, you pay a lot of money to go to hell. It's hard to get rid of the devil. You didn't know that? Sometimes I look at Jesus and say, "How we do? You know what? We don't mock God. You know, I mean, I don't want to be, I'm sorry. Because I am not. I just want you to understand that sometimes I just crush my heart just to know what we are doing to God. Who was fooling? We weren't fooling God anyway. I'm talking about that kind of life. And each one of us know. Now, the way Brother Manam explained it, just go type on your message. Brother Peter, we got to do something because sometimes I forgot. We're going to figure out a way just from the message is on the computer already, right? Yeah, we're going to get from somewhere. I will just give you the verse. Just find it there. The quote, just find there. And I don't have to make this, waste my time doing those things. Because I have a bunch of things to just find it and put that on the screen and we read it. Because it's already had that on a computer there. Brother, I love this church to be different. I love us to act differently. It's not just coming on a prayer meeting for the sake of coming on a prayer meeting. We have to be prepared. We have to be prepared. If I will ask you, say, next day we won't eat, no water, no food. We are fasting because we have a problem. What is the volunteer for that? Really fasting. No fasting just about the thing of the thing. No. You are just you and God. Because we want to get something. We want to dedicate our life. But when I'm saying this, you know what? You say you are eating the manna. Yes, on the out court. Until you cross the veil. You cross the veil, you lock the word. I mean, no noise. You say it's a quiet there. Then you are on a consecrated plate. You are on a dedicated plate. You have meaning. It's not a physical. You shut in with God. You shut in with God. Everything, the TV, the kids, everything, yourself out of that. Yourself out of the picture. You say, God, I surrender all. Amen. It takes practice. It's not something you're going to do that like this. No way, nobody. If you have not done that, it won't come like that. It takes, the first time will be hard. It takes yourself to do it. Keep on doing it. Keep on doing it. It's a practice. Because you are fighting against this flesh. You are fighting against everything, your kids. I mean, everything will come trying to stop you to have a dedicated life. Once you make that decision, you will get a promotion at job, a raise, so you won't be able to do it anymore. Just trying to make good decision to serve God, you're going to see all the things that are going to happen in your life. All kind of things to stop you to do it. That's what I want us to understand tonight. Just if I didn't do anything I wanted, I was coming and said, at least if I can make one point. It's a big difference. And very few Christians have a dedicated life. Very few messages have a consecrated life. Yeah, I believe. I've been president before the foundation of the world. Really? And then what? No wonder. Things are not working. Those people there, they don't even know God. They don't know God, but they gave their life to a point where they're Muslim. They do the thing. They pray 5 times a day. They don't know God. It's like that woman knocking at the door. The judge said, even if I didn't want to serve him, I'm going to serve her. Just I don't want just because she's too much. We have to be too much with God. We have to be too much with God. We have not reached the point. You know what? I reached a point where I just have to say the things the way they are. I'm too old for now. Sometimes I'm about to say sorry. I don't want to say sorry, but I'm not saying sorry anyway. Because we need more from God. And now we cannot get more from God like this. We cannot. Don't fool us. We cannot. How many could not say, yeah, that's good. That's blessings. We got those blessings. Jesus said, we're Christian. Those are good. Those are words. They are good. It's God's word. But they have to fall on a fertile ground. Everything we heard, they have to fall in a heart that has been dedicated to God. That's where the word. I mean, everything we heard is true. No, why does not produce a result? Because the ground is not well prepared for that. The only way you prepare the ground if you give a consecrated life. That's the only way you can prepare your life. That's the only way that God's word can be fruitful in your life, in my life. You have never seen a crop before they put the seed, they got to turn it, we are preparing for the seed to produce. We just come out the ground, we just throw there and it's going to come up. It won't come up like that. It won't come up like that. It takes work, sweat. It takes sweat sometimes. Just gonna think that praying. Remember, I told you about that sermon that Brother is preaching lately about is it anything hard to God? That's on the book of Genesis. Remember, I'm saying on that sermon, I said, I went there, I want to pray, and I kneeled down like that. He was on the rocks. He was hurting on the knees. I changed. I went there, he was on a thorn. I wonder why the mosquito was biting me. Why? Just everything the devil was doing to stop him to pray. Everything the devil will do to stop you praying, he will do. If you will understand that, that's what I'm saying. I like why my brother put it all the time. I have so many good talk with my brother Ken because of that. Brother, let's just press on. When I say press on, what do you mean, press on? You have to understand that sometimes the word just rings so deep in my heart, just to hear, brother, you know what? Sometimes it takes me, just let's press on, brother. Just hear that, just get goosebumps sometimes just to think about. Yeah, we have something to do. We have to have that kind of feeling in your heart every day, that burning desire of, you know what? I didn't see my brother. What's happened? It's not something it's just you feel it. I'm not talking about, you know what? You have to feel it. The Bible doesn't say if you cannot feel for someone, you cannot get in your shoes, you cannot pray for it. You cannot pray for someone. You know what? This is what I'm talking about. It's real life, Christian life. Until you have experienced it, it's going to be word for you. It's something that you have been able to go through it. Then you know how you feel. You know what it means exactly. Oh, well, you in the Bible saying that God didn't ask us to feel anything. Fine. You don't feel anything, you don't get anything, you don't do anything. You know what? We have to, that's what you heard that thing, the burning desire. What does that mean, the burning desire in you? Do you have that burning desire? You know, so I see that young girl here. Each time I see, just I feel so good to see her all the time. She know I told her, I just want to see her. You know, many girls are on the street there. She's by herself here, maybe with a couple of friends. I'm sorry to pick on you, baby. Some wonder why she's here. God is my witness. Just why? Why her? She has a big family. She has mama. She has dada. You know what? Some see how I look at you, people. Each one of you differently. I have to wonder in my mind, what's going on in his mind? What's the relationship with him and God? What do you think about God? You have to have a reason. I don't know what is attracting you. I don't know why you are here. I just want to figure it out. I hope it's for God. I hope we understand you are not wasting your time. That's why I'm talking about the consecrated life. It's too late. You already spent too much. A lot of things you already done. Why kind of just record that? I have the word in French. When the ship is next, just when the ship is turn around, what is that in English? Capsize, something. I like Chavira. I like the French word. Just like that, too far. It's too late. God bless you all. You see, sometimes when I end things like this, I found that Friday, it's a good day for me when I come to church because I can talk to you because you come for a good reason. But end of the day, it's between you and God. Make it personal. Make it personal. You see what I mean, Sissy? Make it personal. Let's go a little bit beyond the church thing. Let's make it personal. When you are by yourself, you think, God, how am I with you? How am I with you? Even nobody sees me. How do you see me? Make it personal. And you will see the difference. You will see the difference. We will see the difference. We will see the difference. There is a demon I want to cast a while to talk about, the demon of shame. I'm going to talk about that demon one day. Shame of what? Shame of who? It's pride. Close demon. It's the one who made Satan fall from heaven. Pride. You see? Yes. Yeah, some people come, like I said, I'm happy you came for communion. I'm done. You see, I love can't something in the church become like it's now. Everybody's quiet, listening, thinking, pondering. That's what God called me to do. I try different way, it doesn't work. That's the only way I know to do it. That's the only thing that God called to do. Which is true. And I've seen that over and over and over. This is my family. Like I told you the other day. This is personal for me. It is. So we have to do something differently. We have to do it differently. Let's clean the house. Let's clean the house. Let's clean the house. There are so many things that we need to get rid of. I look at just, what a waste. I say that, what a waste. That's why I'm talking about consecrated life. And then I can make you read the quote if you want. But we have to cross that veil. Go beyond. There is no noise between you and God. and you talk to God. Once you are there, even a dead tree can produce fruit. You see, that's the message we believe. The message of liberation, the message of freedom. Some say, well, it's not the Bible, it's not this, it's not this. What are you trying to tell me? Now it's 9 o'clock. We are about to move on to communion. Yes, before even the pastor coming from the communion. I love the communion. I told you about that one time. Like I told last Sunday, I hope everybody will be there, and I'm happy that you are there. You have to be able to take that things all the time. We have a table there. Because that's the showdown. I'm going to call that a showdown. That's where you show your color. And I wish I could even stop each one and say, you know, you don't come, you don't come, you don't come. You don't eat, you don't eat, you don't eat. I wish I could. And I want everybody to eat. If you do it wrong, you get in trouble. And then if you're trying to show up, and then what? You get in trouble too. It's a very important. It is the greatest things we can do for ourselves. Because each time we do that, we remind ourselves about Christ. I'm not trying to teach you how to be Christian. That's not my point. I'm not trying to, you know, who are you telling me like that? That's not what I'm trying to do. That's not. But I'm trying to make sure that we understand why we are here. I started by telling you that about being a servant. We are God's servant. It's a good thing to say, I believe the message, I believe Brother Branham, I believe all those things, that it's fine. There is nothing wrong about that. But the Holy Ghost is the real thing. So, while we are getting ready for the communion, the pastor will come. I want everybody to bow his head. Even those who came late, there is something going on. The Holy Spirit is acting. You know that God has just spoke to you. Just because I want this time to be just some time that we kind of make sure that individually, each one of us has a time to think about his life, think about his walk with God. Now, I'll ask you a favor. No matter where you are, know how bad you are, know how many guilt you feel, how many condemn you feel, do me a favor. Just tell God, God, I am sorry. By doing that, I know I don't deserve to be here, but God, I am really sorry. I want to change. No matter how bad it is, say, God, you know what? I don't want to do it anymore. I'm really sorry. I heard your voice. You talked to my heart. I'm really sorry. God, forgive me. I want to be different. If you just got that, will you just tell God by lifting hands? Everybody else, just if something like that happened in your heart, just say, God, you know what? I'm sorry. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God sees me. I mean, you know what? Think about this. When God is saying, where are you coming from? God knows everything. I thank God for that. That's all I wanted to do. You put back your hand between you and God. I just want you to know that. You know what? When I say this, it's between you and God. Because after that, you will come and eat. And then what you are going to commit to God, you know what you told me. God, I'm sorry about this. I'm eating because I think that I want to make everything right. Make it right. Between you and God. And eat. Because this is it. And from now on, say, God, you know what? I want to walk a new life. Walk. I won't be able to do that myself. Hold my hand, oh God. Hold me in my hand, Father. If I'm about to fall, just I want to feel your presence in my hand. You know, this is my prayer too. I want every time, every moment of my life to know that God is with me. That's what matters. That's the only thing that matters. That's the reason why I make you bow your head, so you have time to think about your life. I have time to think about my life, my walk with God. If you are bold enough, yes, tell God that you are going to dedicate your life. You are going to walk a different way, not by yourself, by His help. I'm waiting for the pastor to come for the communion while he's here. So to take the rest of the service. I don't know why God took this way, but that's what it is. I could do all the different way, but I pray before I came out here. Just commit this in God's hand. Just the best I could do, the closest you can go from God, the happiest I will be. Draw nigh to me, then I will come draw to you. The only thing I'm trying to do is just you be close to God. The closest we are with God, the happier we will be. That's what matters. That's why we are here tonight. To be different by God's grace. God bless you.
I surrender. I surrender.